What is, however, something that can be addressed is the secondary injury phase. This starts almost immediately after the initial force was transmitted, and then it can continue for days to weeks. It's a biochemical process with lots of different chemical reactions, and it's very poorly understood, but I think as far as general medical field, it's moving towards cytokines and inflammatory processes, and it's the same thing with spinal cord injury. It turns out that is the one thing that we can address. And several theories exist as to what exactly is the mechanism behind secondary injury. There's the free radical theory. It's the depletion of your antioxidants, free radicals accumulate, damage cell membranes. Calcium theory, again, influx of calcium into the cell due to, you know, stretch or swelling, activation of your phosphorylases, and again, mitochondrial failure, cell membrane disruption. There's a theory that says that your endogenous opioids somehow propagate the original injury. I'm not sure what the mechanism of it is, but for instance, naloxone have been used in trials and shown some moderate benefit, but not statistically significant. And then there's the inflammatory theory, which basically just says that you have your inflammatory mediators, your cytokines, your oligotrines, the usual culprits accumulating in the core and causing cell damage there locally. And then once a secondary injury process has been initiated, cell death ensues. Two causes of cell death, or two mechanisms of cell death, would be necrosis. Usually this is at the time of the accident, and then actually programmed cell death with apoptosis also occurs, mostly in your oligodendrocytes. And this causes axonal degeneration adjacent to the lesion. You'll have a transection, but then your cord will virtually die around it as well. Cystic degeneration of the central gray matter occurs, you get like a syrinx basically, and then forms what's called a glial scar that creates a mechanical barrier that even if the axons did want to degenerate, they can't, because there's a glial scar. So all these things that have been identified as pathogenic mechanisms are possible targets for therapies to stop, for instance, the formation of the glial scar, to stop cystic degeneration, etc. Let's get to the management. The goals of treatment is, obviously we're looking at the patient as a whole, and we'll get to the ABCs now, but goals of treatment of your spinal cord injury is to realign the spine, to prevent loss of function and damaged tissue. That's a secondary injury that you have to prevent. Improve neurological recovery, obtain stability, and then early functional rehabilitation. So the emergency management starts in the field. And there's actually been a marked improvement in outcomes in neurology or spinal cord injured patients since the improvement in training and awareness of your personnel. This is not new, but the fact that they now, that every patient is managed as if it's got a spinal cord injury, the use of spinal and trauma boards, white collars, it has made a huge difference. It's one of the contentious issues, what is the neutral position, how should the spine be immobilized? And there's no consensus about this again, but in a position of slight flexion, which they say is about equal to 2 centimeters of elevation of the occiput, you get widening of the spinal canal at the level of C5-6, which is a good level because it's quite a common site of dislocations and fractures. And then the patient must be immediately transported to the trauma facility. So ABCs, your airway and breathing is always still your first priority, whilst of course maintaining elasticity of the cervical spine. And aspiration of gastric contents and then hemodynamic shock are actually the two biggest causes of death prior to hospital arrival, so it's not something that should be taken lightly, of course. And with the high C-spine injuries, just due to the secondary injury process that we've discussed, the patient can have, for instance, a C4 injury, be able to breathe spontaneously when he gets to hospital, and then one level up from swelling, it becomes apneic. So this patient, they actually recommend that your severe spinal cord injured patients should be monitored in an ICU or high care setting for at least a week, just due to all these other considerations. Okay, and then circulation, this is a bigger topic in spinal cord injured patients, just because it's so hard to, especially again in your high injuries, to maintain hemodynamic stability. Because there is volume depletion on the one hand from associated injuries, intra-abdominal bleeding, pelvic fractures, lumbar fractures, something like that. and then also neurogenic shock and spinal shock. What's the difference? We'll get to that now. And then what's also important is there's a that the injured spinal cord, the same as the injured brain, you can basically infer quite a lot in the management of your spinal cord injury from traumatic brain injury, which has been abundant research, is that the cord is now unable to auto-regulate blood flow, same as the injured brain. So if you have a systemic hypertension, you won't be able to compensate for that. So it's left quite vulnerable. And there hasn't been a lot of studies in the literature about specifically spinal cord injured patients and what's the ideal blood pressure, etc. But there's been a lot on traumatic brain injury, and they have found, so in not very well publicized trials, but that the same rules apply and that the outcomes are better if you actively resuscitate and get the blood pressure above 90, the systolic above 90, you get your saturation 100%. And this is just to maintain as good as possible blood and oxygen supply to the injured cord. Now, why is neurogenic shock? At this, in your high spinal cord injuries above level of T6, you get loss of your sympathetic outflows. You've got an unopposed vagal outflow, which means that you will not have vasoconstriction, you will not have a tachycardia. And patients then present with hypotension and a relative bradycardia. So this is how you can distinguish it from hemodynamic shock. One thing that's important in this case is that there's quite a significant risk of fluid overload if you're trying to correct the hypovolemia or the hypotension merely with fluid. And they recommend invasive monitoring, even in the newest articles with a Swan-Ganz catheter, even though this is something that the guys at Fritzky, it's almost considered like sacrilege or blasphemy to talk about Swan-Ganz catheters, but it's old school. But they say it's the only way to make sure that you do not fluid overload, and then inotropes should be used if you cannot maintain your blood pressure with fluid. And I'm just putting this in because I don't know, there's often confusion between what's the difference between neurogenic shock and spinal shock. Neurogenic shock refers to the systemic loss of, or the systemic sympathectomy, so the one I just mentioned. And then spinal shock refers to the physiological interruption of all function below the level of the injury. So you're basically going to have a flaccid paralysis, a reflexive nerve sensation, bowel and bladder dysfunction, and then one of the typical features of the spinal shock is a sustained priapism. And this can use, this usually lasts 1 to 4 days about, and how you know it's over is that your bubble cavernosus reflex will be the first one to return, and that's then you can accurately assess, you know, the severity of the injury, because at this stage, there's just nothing. And I'll get to the D of the ABCDs. Once you've stabilized the patient, he's got all his monitors and his catheter and he's intubated, but it was necessary, then full neurological examination needs to be done, and then also appropriate imaging according to the IDLS protocol. And of course, this does include the C-spine, but also the other ones, chest X-ray and the pelvic X-ray. And in your conscious patient, your first step will be taking a history, finding out what happened. Was it were you a driver, were you a pedestrian, did you fall? Was there any temporary sensory or motor loss? This will also give you a clue as to what you can expect later on. You head to toe exam, including your cranial nerves, and a classical coma scale, because I don't have it on here, but there's a very high incidence of concomitant injury, like they say for patients with significant spinal trauma, about 25% also have a head injury. And of patients with a head injury, about 5% will have a G-spine injury. So there's quite a bit of correlation, so you can't just ignore the brain. And then, as a head-to-toe examination, back in front, log roll the patient, look at the spine. While he is log rolled, do a rectal exam, do your bubble cavernosus reflex, and then also exclude any other associated injuries that you might have missed. Now, I'll just briefly go through the typical cord syndromes. You've got the central cord syndrome that we mentioned previously, presents with the more severely affected upper limbs. This is, of course, if it's in your C-spine, which it usually is. And you see this in all the patients with long-standing spondylosis and osteophytes, and also congenital spinal canal stenosis will also predispose to this. You get spastic quadriplegia with your hands and your upper limbs affected more. You usually have sacral sparing, the same reason. So you see that part's affected. Okay. Anterior cord syndrome, this is the worst prognosis of all your partial cord syndromes. It's usually caused by flexion injuries with the functional compression of the anterior spinal artery. You get a complete motor paralysis, and the only thing that's saved basically is your dorsal column sensation, so vibration, proprioception, and fine touch.